Hey everyone, I'm Kirby from Virtual Airshows, and today I'm trying to explore the differences and the similarities between real-world aerobatics and virtual aerobatics. To help, I'm joined by Flight Lieutenant David Simmonds, who flies the Red 5 position in the Royal Airforce Aerobatic Team, the Red Arrows. How are you doing today, David?
Very good, thank you very much. I'm coming to you live here from RAF Scampton. I've just come straight out of a debrief. I've been flying earlier this afternoon. So it's a real delight to be able to welcome you all online here and be able to have a chat with you today. So.
One of our goals here at Virtual Airshows is to inspire others in learning the art of formation aerobatics. Obviously, one of the challenges to be overcome is staying within your box and not endangering others. The good thing about virtual reality is that there are no serious repercussions to any mistakes. In the real world, have you ever thought to yourself, you know what, flying 6 feet from another aircraft isn't for me? And what mental challenges does this come with?
Well, thank you for that question. That's clearly on our minds all the time and every time that we do fly. And we brief thoroughly how we're going to deal with those sort of situations. So we do honour the box, which is a mythical piece of airspace, which is surrounding the jets. And like you say, we do fly up to around about 6 feet from each other. So the overall kind of the way we work is the higher numbers have to avoid the lower numbers. So if you do slide out of your box, say if number three slides a little bit further left towards me at number five, it's my job to react to avoid number three. Having said that, if you're grossly out of position though, as say if you are from number three, then we will initiate an escape maneuver. So when we brief and we talk about what each maneuver we're going to do, if we have any kind of problems, engine problem or anything like that, we brief the escapes. So an escape is generally a full power onto what we call the light buffet, and it's a escape away from that formation. So to keep it safe, we don't just plug away and just hope it will come back together. If we're grossly outside our box, we will get out of there and escape from the formation. So that's how we do it.
And another challenge that is common with virtual aerobatics is something nicknamed death gripping. This is when a pilot unconsciously holds the stick too tightly, which can hurt their hands. Also, those who are wearing a virtual reality headset, as I have here, may sometimes strain their neck from looking too far to the side for too long at their reference. As a real formation pilot yourself, have you ever encountered any similar physical issues?
Yes, absolutely. I'll break that down into the sort of the two subjects. So the death grip is certainly something that we can face, and you can kind of feel it when you're just over tightening on that stick. And when you over tighten on that stick, then things become a little bit more pitchy, and you're not reacting in a smooth kind of input to that control that you want. Equally, on a very bumpy day where the weather is challenging, you may want to just increase that grip just slightly, just to make sure that you are holding the stick and not fighting the weather conditions and turbulence. So that's the death grip side of things. We'll often tell ourselves just to wiggle the toes and fingers and just to keep that input smooth. And we go with an input. So that should be the same whether it's smooth or bumpy. And so it's just training the hand into each of those kind of positions for each maneuver. Onto the physical aspect of it, we all train for our own position. Something like Lightning that we flew last year, I'm very, very wide away from the boss, and I'll spend my entire life just looking over my right shoulder, and we're looking at different references on the boss's jet, number one's jet. So you can just find yourself sat in a position that your neck is cranked over, and you're putting a lot of G, which is just straining into your neck. So absolutely, we do aircrew conditioning programs to keep us fit, and then we train specifically to what we're doing, so load work, a little bit of extra fizz does go a long way. And an extra stretching work, even yoga, that kind of stuff does really help in terms of the repetitive nature of what we do. Because you're wearing a helmet that weighs, you know, 10 pounds or so, and you're pulling 60, and suddenly weighing 60. So significant forces on your neck when it's twisted doing some aerobatics. So absolutely, it's all about keeping fit, getting to the gym, and that will sustain you then for the whole season.
Okay, so the pilots flying at today's show won't be able to feel any tension or force feedback on the aircraft. How does the aircraft feel and react in real life? And do you think that the lack of feedback could act as an advantage or a disadvantage to the virtual pilots?
In terms of the, I can tell you what it's like from our perspective, and then you might have to draw some of your own conclusions. I've just been flying today and it's been a perfectly smooth day. A front has come through and it's on the backside of that front. It's just perfectly calm. But having said so, formation aerobatics, that should be the easiest time to do that. Having said that, every jet is different. So some have a slightly heavier nose. Some have different kit in them and they've got a different center of gravity. Some have a slightly different stick position. It's just all made very slightly differently. So we try and fly the same jets for the whole season. We have a name on the side of them, so you know which one's yours. And so you get very used to how that jet flies. So when you do a loop, you'll put the same input in on that jet. Clearly, you know, you can't do that for the whole season. Jets go unserviceable and that kind of stuff. So you step into a spare or so on. So over the we then brief to that. So the first two or three turns that you do with a jet are then key to how that performance will go. So you're getting used to then the input of that new jet, how that feels and how slightly different those things are to the feel of the jet. So I absolutely think it's crucial that you get some kind of feedback, because then you can do a consistent show. Because it feels the same every time. And if it's offered on a joystick that doesn't give you feedback, then I don't know how you would replicate the same conditions every time. So when the weather gets bad, and it's very bumpy in some low-level turbulence conditions, we're attempting to put the same input in as we do for a smooth day. It's just the jets are bucking around a little bit and we're trying to ignore that and just absolutely fly the same input as we do every time. So to get that consistency, then you definitely need some kind of feedback from the jet.
Okay. And talking on the topic of feedback, does the Hawk's power react quickly to the throttle inputs, or is there any latency?
So we've actually had the engines in the Hawks that we fly modified. So it's a Hawk T1, which is pretty old now, sort of 30 years old or so. The training version of that, which was at Aero Valley, did used to have quite a latency in the engine. It had a spool up time from idle to full power of around about 7 seconds, which is just a bit too long for us. We want a constant kind of reaction, an instantaneous reaction. So we've had our engines modified to give them a quicker spool up time. And that makes formation aerobatics easier. There is some spool up time. It does take, you know, a second or two for that engine to kick in. And so how we get around that is sometimes we'll play with the air brake against power. So you can power up, and if you're going to go short, you can use the air brake rather than the power to adjust that position sometimes to save you spooling up or idling that engine.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, that's quite interesting. And so for those watching that don't know, a pilot-induced oscillation, or a PIO, is when a pilot inputs an overcorrection and then they react by that by counteracting with another overreaction. So David, how common are PIOs in the real world, taking into account the resistance of the stick, and how do you prevent that from happening? And when they do occur, what is the procedure to safely reducing them?
So PIIs absolutely do occur, and we want to train to avoid them. And so we brief to a certain technique. So when the boss calls and pulling up, say if I over pull, so I'm going to pull, we call that going shallow. So that's, I've over pulled to where the boss is, so I'm sitting high on the boss. What we brief to do is not back that off. We just hold that position. and you hold it for 2 or 3 seconds, and then we have what's called a half error technique. So we just half that error and then slide it back into formation. If you try and make the adjustment all in one go, then you typically will go through the formation and then end up through it deep, which is what you're describing as a pilot-induced oscillation. When you get down through it deep, you want to correct, and you go overly correct, and you end up doing this shallow all the way. So what we use is what is this half-error technique. So you hold the error, accept it, and then you just take out half of that error and then slide it back in. And it sounds easier. It says, you know, saying it sounds easy. It's in reality, when you see a big error, you want to fix it straight away. And it takes some real discipline to avoid striving for that, because you always want to be on the right reference and striving for perfection as what we do. But like you say, that is a danger. And if we have a depth swap like that in the air, then it's for other airplanes not to react to. And that's very distracting when you've got a jet that close to you bucking around like that. And when we come to a brief and the debrief, especially in the debrief, everything is filmed, what we do. And we replay that, and you can see exactly when people put inputs in, and we debrief to that individually to then stop it happening again. So if you've had a PIO on a trip, say in the morning, but you're going flying in the afternoon, then when it comes to the next brief, you say, right, in that maneuver, I'm not going to over-tighten there and then back it off and that kind of stuff. So we talk about it in great detail.
So the technique we use in the virtual teams is when we're looking at the lead and we're on an outer wing, if that individual makes a PIO and gets in the way of our view or the reference on the lead, we kind of burn that image of the lead in our mind, and we try to hold it there. Is that something you guys do too?
Yes, we absolutely fly off leader. So all our inputs are reference red one. So sometimes you can see someone bucking around inside you, and if you just ignore them then and hold your reference on the leader, then that should smooth that out. That's definitely true, but we still adhere to the principle of, you know, fire. And I've got to avoid the person inside me as well. So if they have a big transgression, then, you know, I need to be in a position to react to that. But fortunately, it doesn't happen very often. And, you know, overtraining is really how we iron that out. So the more you fly, the better you'll get, and the less chance you'll have those. But certainly we've seen in early days, new pilot joining the team, that can certainly happen. And then we just debrief of how to get out of it.
Yeah. So everyone assumes that avoiding a collision is the biggest cause of concern, and it might well be. But during a live show, or any type of sortie, to be fair, is there other things to think about, such as ensuring manoeuvres are executed correctly? And what can you tell us about all the different things that go through your head before a training sortie or a live show?
So one of the roles I have here on the team is I'm called Uncle Enid. So I'm in the front five, but also one of my jobs is to make sure that the front five is prepared well for every show. The boss can be a very busy individual, so he might well be doing some other PR and that kind of stuff. So what we'll typically do is just before the brief, say 10 minutes before the brief, whatever we're doing, if that means, you know, stopping engagements, PR and that kind of stuff, we will take that 10 minutes to talk through what we're going to do and what's different on the day and of where we are. Pressure can build, and everyone deals with it, I think, in their own different way. People I've seen in this job actually quite routine dependent. So whether it be, you know, coming in and having a cup of tea is the first thing you do in the day, then it just helps, you know, you stick to your routine, and then, you know, it, over time it becomes kind of a bit more normal of what you're doing, which is not normal. So when we'll pre-brief for 10 minutes, so that's really highlighting the new things of what this particular show is all about. And then by doing that, it just gets you into the right zone, right frame of mind. You know, if you've been dealing with a lot of people, engaging with the public, which is all part of our job, which is great, we just need to seal ourselves off for that 10 minutes, and we call it forming a bubble. And once we're in that bubble, it's nothing, no distractions, and then absolutely get our head in the right space to go flying and just concentrate purely on that flying. I can't think of a time when I've been flying formation aerobatics thinking about other things, you know, at home or outside of what I'm doing. So you absolutely need to get your head in the right headspace. and whatever it takes to do that. The synchro pair will probably train a little bit differently. They're looking for specific points on the ground for cross points and that kind of stuff. We have an exec who's number 9 in the team who's overseeing the whole thing, and then we'll step into the brief ready, having looked at ground geographic features, all of that stuff, note headings that are important to us for that particular site. So if we're going into a break, we'll all have different headings that we'll fly to for that break, for instance. Make sure all of that prep has been done. And sometimes a show will be not at home base, so we might be taking off from, say, Scampton, but doing a show on a coastal location, say in Bournemouth, with, you know, 500,000 people on the beach on a summer's day. So it's getting there to that show and back from it in a safe manner as well. So we'll have one person who's dedicated and is the, what we call the navigator for that sortie, who then is in charge of how we're going to get from Scampton to that show, and has done all of the coordination work. So plenty going on behind the scenes before we've even got to a show, and how we do it safely. But to your answer your question, it's getting in the headspace, it's putting all of the extra stuff that goes with this job to one side and just concentrating purely on, so when we call, when the boss calls smoke on go and pulling up, we're in that right headspace to go with that pull, not think about anything else.
Okay, that's great. That's all the questions I have. Thank you for your answers. They're quite interesting.
No problem at all. It, obviously, quite technical in terms of all that kind of stuff. I hope that's you can relate to me in terms of we're doing it in the real world, but hopefully some of that takes across to what you're doing in the virtual world as well. And I'm sure there's going to be loads of similarities about how we do things. And I'm sure there'll be some differences too. So I'm always interested in your feedback
Yeah, definitely.
Back to us, because we can always learn something from you.